No one remembers. That is strange.
Is P2 minus P1 is equal to H rho G?
Yes. Thank God you are remembering what we have discussed in 11th. You cannot afford to forget that, okay? Looking for the JEE Mains, whatever exam, competitive exam you write, will be class 11 syllabus. Okay? This is the variation of pressure with height. Okay. Now, what if you have point number one here and point number two is at the same...
So we are not able to see your screen.
Yes, sir.
Okay, sorry. Now?
Yes, sir.
Okay, suppose this is point one, that is point two. They're separated by a distance of x. So now tell me, what is the relation? Is P1 equal to P2?
Yes, sir. They are the same
height. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
They are equal. The assumption is no acceleration horizontally. No acceleration is in horizontal direction. But if the entire beaker accelerate with acceleration A, all right, then it is, then it will be like, you know, P1 will have higher pressure. So P1 will be equal to P2 plus rho A X. Are you getting it? This also you should know. Pressure can change horizontally if acceleration is there in the horizontal direction. But most of the time, there is no acceleration in the horizontal direction. So that is why we don't consider that. Okay. Now we are going to take a quick, I know, very, very simple numerical so that you can refresh from your memories. Suppose this is the beaker, okay? And on the beaker, you are placing a test tube, all right? And how you're placing the test tube is such a way that you are first putting this test tube completely inside the beaker so that the test tube is filled with the liquid, okay? And then you are pulling the side up, which is closed. So there is no air over here. So it is close to vacuum. So pressure is how much over here?
Zero. Zero.
Okay.
Zero.
Right. So suppose this rises by a height of h and density of the liquid is rho. Then here, since it is open to atmosphere, it will have an atmospheric pressure P naught. Okay. And by the way, atmospheric pressure, it is good idea to remember 1.013 × 10⁵ pascals. Okay. Now, can I find out atmospheric pressure P naught based on the value of H and rho? Zero. Atmospheric pressure, I am asking. So tell me, if I draw a horizontal line like this, pressure along all the points along this horizontal line will be same or not? Right? Pressure along all these, all the points on this line will be same. Right, so the same pressure will be over here also. So over this point, at this point, pressure should be P naught only, because P naught was the pressure over here, which has the same level. And I know pressure over there is zero. So this is zero. So zero plus rho g h should be equal to P naught. So P naught is rho g h. All right. So if you use mercury, by the way, you should know the density of mercury also, because it's a very common fluid. It is 13.6 times the density of the water. So if you use mercury over here and you substitute the value of G and P naught, you're going to get H as how much? 76 centimeter, right? So atmospheric pressure corresponds to 76 centimeter of the mercury. So at times pressure is given in terms of height of mercury. So pressure will be simply rho g into height of mercury, if you want to find out in proper units. Okay. Now, can you tell me, achha, by the way, this instrument is called barometer. Barometer is used to determine the atmospheric pressure. Okay. Now, there is one more instrument, but you don't need to know the working. You can directly apply the basics and tell me what I'm trying to ask you there. Draw this with me. All those who joined late, today we have decided to revisit the fluid mechanics. So we'll do as much as possible today, and then I'll circulate the videos so that you can complete the revision at your end. I'll not rush very fast, but also I'll not go very slow. Okay, so suppose there is this kind of instrument connected to a chamber whose pressure is P. Okay, there is this chamber whose pressure is P, and this U-tube is filled with mercury. It is filled with mercury. It so happens that the difference in the levels of the mercury is H, and outside pressure is P naught. Now P naught, how do I know what is P naught? You can use barometer to determine P naught. Once you determine P naught, you can also determine the value of P by using this instrument. This instrument is called manometer, by the way. Okay. So can you tell me what is P in terms of P naught?
P naught plus H rho g.
P is P naught plus H rho g, yeah.
So again, you draw a line like this, horizontal line. Along this horizontal line, pressure should be same. Okay. I'm assuming that the gas is such that the for gas pressure doesn't vary in the vertical direction, because the density of gas is very less. Otherwise, for gas also, you have to use P2 is equal to P1 plus rho gh. Okay. But approximately, I can say that pressure over here is P only. So pressure over here is also P. All right. So P should be equal to P naught plus rho G H. Right. So if you know what is H, if you know what is P naught, you'll get to know what is P. You can calculate H by just putting a scale over here. You know, it is visible. You can get it easily. Right. So this is the small portion of the chapter which talks about the variation of pressure. All right. Now, because the pressure is changing as you go down, the outcome of that is the buoyant force. Please write down. So buoyant force is due to am I going very fast or it is all right? You can text me privately also, you can message me or WhatsApp, whatever. Is it all right? The pace is fine?
Yes, sir.
So you're saying yes on behalf of everyone?
No, sir, on behalf of me.
Okay. All right. Great. So let's continue. So due to variation of pressure, in vertical direction. That is why buoyant force exists. All right. Now tell me if some object is freely falling, will there be a pressure variation in vertical direction? No one? Okay. See,
could you repeat what is it?
So if the bucket of water is falling vertically with action due to gravity only, as the bucket is falling freely. Okay? Like this. Acceleration is G. Then there will not be any variation of pressure vertically. Okay, the pressure variation happens only when the bucket is stationary. Okay, so when you say that this is point one, this is point two, P2 is equal to P1 plus rho GH only when the fluid is stationary. Okay, and suppose there is an acceleration, let's say acceleration vertically down is A1, then it will be written as P1 plus rho G minus A1 times H. Okay. And if A1 becomes equal to G, the pressure variation doesn't happen vertically. So if pressure variation doesn't happen, then there will not be any buoyant force also, because buoyant force is because of pressure variation in vertical direction. Okay. Now let's discuss a little bit about the buoyant force. We'll talk about its properties. Okay, buoyant force is basically applied by the fluid on any object which is partially, please write down with me, partially or completely submerged. Okay, The direction of buoyant force is in which direction? Anyone? Direction of buoyant force, where?
Upward
direction.
Buoyant force is upwards. Upward as in opposite to the acquisition due to gravity. Okay? Vertically upward. There is no exception to it. Magnitude is what? Magnitude, anyone remember?
So is it the same VOG?
Magnitude is equal to the weight of liquid displaced by the object. Okay? It is always true. Weight is what? Mass of the liquid displaced. Mass of liquid displaced into G. And mass of the liquid displaced, it was density of the liquid, okay, into volume of the object which is inside the liquid into G. Because if V volume is inside the liquid, then V volume is displaced, isn't it? So the mass displaced will be density of liquid into the volume which is inside the liquid. If the object is sinking, if object is completely inside, then it has essentially displaced the entire volume of its, okay? But if it is only partially submerged, ADV, who is ADV? ADV, you are on mute, I think. Now you can speak, ADV.
Yes, sir.
Who is ADV?
Sir, Advait.
Advait. Okay. Now I'm muting you. All right. So this is rho LVG vertically upwards. And the if object is completely inside, okay, if object is completely inside, the buoyant force will be rho L VG, and the gravity force will be density of the solid into V into G. Okay, so if the buoyant force is less than the weight of the object, or the liquid density is less than the solid's density, then the solid will be sinking inside. Okay? But if density of liquid is more than the density of solid, then the solid can float. Fine? Now, I'm going to ask you a small question. If you have a beaker like this, which is made up of steel, can this object float on the water or it will sink? Can it float? It is made up of steel. Density of steel is, of course, more than the water. Can it float?
No.
What does your intuition say? It will float, right? Yeah, you might have done this, right? You have, like, in when you were a kid, you were like, you have started playing with the mobile phone now only, like when there was no smartphone and you were playing with whatever come in your hand. So this you might have done. You've taken a plate of steel and put it on the water, which is stationary. The steel will float. Okay, then how come steel is floating? Steel is floating because steel is able to displace more volume than its own volume. Okay, the volume of steel is very less. It is a very thin material. Okay, but it has displaced this much water. Okay, it has displaced this much water, which is more than its own volume. Okay, but then if you take a steel plate and if you vertically put it down like this, then it will just sink. It will not be able to displace the same. Correct. So it will not be able to displace the weight of the water, which is equal to its own weight when you're putting the plate like this vertically. But if you put it horizontally, it will be able to displace water which has more volume than its own volume. Okay, so the shape enables that.
So I have a question. If we invert the beaker, the container, right, it'll sink.
If you invert the beaker, it may sink if there is no air trapped. If there is air trapped, the liquid won't be able to, you know, if you're putting it like this, this is what you mean, right? So yeah. If air is trapped here, then it may not sink. Air has to get out. If air is out, then it will sink.
Okay.
Fine.
Yeah,
so
got it.
This is the fluid static. Okay. And one more thing, the buoyant force, please write down. Buoyant force point of application is through the center of mass of the submerged portion. Okay, it's not the center of mass of the entire object. The buoyant force, suppose you have to apply the torque equation, then you have to take into account the torque due to buoyant force also. Okay, so the point of application of buoyant force you should know, otherwise how will you write torque, which is force into perpendicular distance from the force? So point of application of buoyant force is center of mass of the submerged portion. For example, if there is a beaker like this and you have a stick which is hanging on like that, it is hinged here, and the stick is inside the water like that. So mg will be acting from the center of mass. This is mg. Okay, and buoyant force will act from the center of mass of the submerged portion. This will be liquid, the density of liquid volume which is displaced into G. So basically from here to here, you find out the volume of the solid, that much volume the liquid is displaced. So this much will be the force, buoyant force, apart from mg and the normal direction also you can take. Fine, so these are the some basic things. Now let us take few questions on fluid statics, then we'll get into the fluid dynamics. Okay. So I've already downloaded it. So you can see, I'll tell you which question to do, okay? Fifth question. You are able to read the question, right? There is no difficulty.
Is it A, maximum at D and, I mean, minimum at D and maximum at B?
Okay, fine. Let's see.
It will be maximum at B.
the pressure varies like this downwards because of acceleration due to gravity. Pressure increases in this direction because of this acceleration. Pressure increases backward also. Okay, so D will have the least pressure, and you can say pressure of A is more than D, but pressure of B is maximum. Okay, so B is maximum, D is minimum. All right, let's proceed. Do the sixth question, number six. Okay, many have answered since A.
So is it D?
D. Okay,
Kavi. Yes, sir, D point.
Fine, I'll quickly talk about it. You draw a horizontal line like this, and then you say pressure along this line has to be equal. So pressure over here will be atmospheric pressure, which is over there, plus density of glycerin G into 0.1 meters, rho GH. This should be equal to atmospheric pressure plus density of oil G into H, plus from here to here you have to take. Okay, this length will be 0.1 minus H meters. Okay, so density of mercury G into 0.1 minus H. Okay, so P naught and P naught gone. All right, so you know the density of glycerin, density of mercury, and oil density is also given. The densities are given in gram per centimeter cube. Okay. So you, if you multiply it with 1000, you'll get in kg per meter cube. Okay, so G, G, G is gone. So 0.1 times rho G is equal to rho naught times H plus rho M times 0.1 minus H. You can, you know, substitute density in terms of gram per centimeter cube also, because left hand side and right hand side both have the density, so multiplication factor will get cancelled away. So you substitute the values of density and you'll get the value of H. Fine. And
so D, right?
I'm confirming. Sixth is D. D for Delhi. Okay. Do the do the 10th question. 10th is slightly tricky, but it will be nice if you solve it yourself.
Thank you.
Okay, someone got the answer. Brinda saying B. Should I solve?
So once again.
There is a variation of pressure in x direction as well as y direction. Simply use the formulas that we have discussed.
Is it B?
2 meter per second square. Okay, Sri Ramya is saying D. All right, let us see how to solve this question. So first step, I'll draw a horizontal line like this. So L-shaped tube is kept inside the bus that is moving with constant acceleration. During the motion, level of one liquid is 12, whereas the right arm, it is 8 centimeter. When the orientation of the tube is shown, assuming the diameter is smaller, you need to find the acceleration of bus, okay? Let's say acceleration of bus is A, okay? So this is 45 degree, this is 90 degree, this also should be 45 degree. Okay. So the horizontal distance, did you find what is the horizontal distance? This distance is how much? Anyone got it? This distance. Okay. So this is 8, since it is 45 degree, this also will be 8 only, and this will be 12. So 12 plus 8, 20 centimeter. Correct. So this is 0.2 meters, okay? So I will reach here from here. Let's say this is 0.1, this is 0.2. So P2 will be equal to P1 plus rho A into 0.2, rho A into X, fine, okay? And P1 is basically atmospheric pressure, P0, fine? And let's say this is 0.3, okay? So that distance is 12 minus 8, which is 4 centimeter, okay? So P2 is also equal to, if I take vertically from P3 plus rho g into h, that is 0.04. Okay, and I also know that P3 is nothing but P0, it is open to atmosphere. Okay, so when I use this, okay, I will equate P0 plus rho g into 0.04 to be equal to P0 plus rho A into 0.2, P0 gone, rho is gone, and if you take G as 10, then 0.4 is equal to 0.2 times A, and from here A is coming out to be 2 meter per second square. Fine. All right, so this is how you have to do this. Now tell me one thing, if you have a beaker like this, and let's say the beaker's dimension is, this length is given as L, okay? If this beaker accelerates forward, the top portion will remain horizontal or it will be inclined?
Inclined.
It will be inclined, right? And it will be inclined like this. You can probably refer to your own experience, it will be like that. Okay. So basically, I am asking you to find out this angle theta. How much will be angle theta? Acceleration due to gravity is G vertically downwards. Try finding it out.
So it's just A by G, right? No, I mean.
Theta is A by G. Solve it like a numerical. If you know already, don't refer to your, you know, what you have remembered. Solve it. Even if you know it, get the answer. Okay? Tan theta is A by G. Just correct. So if I draw a line like this, and let's say this is H. So tan theta should be equal to H by L. Okay. Let's say this is 0.1, 0.2, and this is 0.3. So P2 is equal to P1 plus rho AL. And P2 is also equal to P3 plus rho GH. And P1 is this atmosphere. P3 is also atmospheric pressure open to the atmosphere. Okay. So P1 is equal to P3. So if I write it down like this, P1 plus rho AL equal to P3 plus rho GH, then P1 is equal to P3. So they go away. Rho and rho goes away, and I will get H by L is equal to A by G. So tan of theta, which is H by L, is also equal to A by G. Okay. Fine. 13th question number 13. Should I solve? The pressure is not constant throughout the area. Pressure changes.
So the previous one could have just used the tan theta is equal to A by G, right?
Yes. Could have been done directly, but if you stick to the basics, you feel a lot in control. No one got 13th. Okay, Brinda is getting B, Kavya is getting A, others. Okay. So basically there is a spring mechanism over here. So if you draw the free body diagram of this surface, it will experience a spring force of K times delta X like this, and there will be a force because of the pressure. Let's say F is that force, okay? So F minus K delta X should be zero because this surface is stationary, it is not accelerating. So net force should be zero. F should be equal to K delta X. Now delta X is what is asked. Delta X is F by K. The problem is, I don't know what is F. K is given to me. So I need to find the value of F. Okay. How to find the value of F? I'll just multiply pressure with the area. But the problem is, pressure at every point is changing. Pressure over here is something else. Pressure over there is something else. Everywhere pressure is different. Okay. So if I look this surface from this side, then I will see it as a square plate. Okay. And fluid will be like, you know, outside of the screen. So if I consider a small strip like this, if I consider a small strip of width dh at a distance of h, then since this width is so less, I can assume that pressure is practically constant for this width dh, all right? And this is separated by two halves. Okay, so the length and the width of this plate is also A only, okay? So the area of the strip is A into dh, okay? So area, the small area is A into dh. Pressure over there is atmospheric pressure plus rho gh. Fine. So basically the force, the small force on that strip will be P naught plus rho gh, which is the pressure multiplied by the area, adh. Now you need to be very careful here because, okay, listen here, listen guys, I'm talking something important, okay? You need to be careful here because atmospheric pressure is applying force from this direction also, okay? So in that process, you may ignore that, all right? So there is a force from this side which is equal to P naught into the total area, which is P naught into A square, fine? So this equation, you need to, if you consider total force, then you have to write over here F minus P into A square is that. So delta X will be equal to F minus pressure, atmospheric pressure into A naught. a square. Okay. So this is the force, small force, total force will be integral of this. Integral of h goes from 0 to a. So this will give you p naught into a square plus rho g. This will give you rho g. I'll make some space here. Rho g into a into h dh, right? So h dh, when you integrate, becomes h square by 2. So you will get a cube by 2, like this. This is your force. This is my the value of F. So F minus P A square, F minus P A square is basically rho G A cube by 2. Fine. So delta X is nothing but this divided by the spring constant. So rho G A cube divided by 2 times K. This is my delta X. Fine. So this is how you have to solve this. Is there any doubt? No doubts? Okay. This one. Do the third question. Third one. Final answer for this 13th question is A, 1.3 centimeter. Okay, do it now. Question number 3. Have you understood the question? Actually, the question is not very clear. Somebody has understood. Yeah, it is not very clear. So leave it. Let's not get into that. Let me read the question and then give it to you. Fourth question. Fourth is good. Try solving the fourth one. Question number 4. Leave third one. Third is unclear.
So you scroll down a bit, hey, go a bit up.
What?
Can you scroll up a bit, sir?
Is it not visible?
So the scroll down a bit.
Are you seeing question number 4 properly?
You said 3, right?
You're not listening. I am asking you to call 4. Okay, Britta got the answer. Others? Okay, I will do it now.
Is it D? 30 kgs.
30 kgs. Let's see. First, I will tell you how to go about it. Then I'll show you the answer. Okay. So you need to assume that suppose it is completely sink. Then what are the forces acting on it? There will be a buoyant force. Okay. If volume of this solid is V, the buoyant force is rho GV, entire volume is displaced. Okay. And then there will be an mg force. Okay, mass is directly given. So I don't need to write m in terms of density. So this is mg. Okay, m which is given to me. And also there is another mass kept on the top. So because of that, a normal reaction will be applied on this volume, which is equal to mass which you are adding up into G downwards. Okay. So when you balance all the forces, you are going to get rho GV minus M plus M times G should be equal to zero. Okay. So G is gone. And you're going to get small m as density of the liquid into volume of the solid minus capital M as your answer, additional mass which you have to keep. Now, density of the water is 1000, right? It is 1000. And the volume of the solid, how will you find? Density of the solid is given and the mass of the solid is given. So volume you can find out by dividing the mass with the density. 120 divided by 600, okay, minus 120. This is how much anyone has done like this. 200 minus 120, which is 80 kgs. Okay, like this you have to do. All right. Solve the 7th question. Question number 7.
So can you show options?
No, options will not be shown. Did you get the answer?
I'm doing it.
Okay, I will solve it now.
Sir, are you able to hear me?
Yes.
Okay, it's MG nu minus 1.
MG mu minus 1. It is not mu, it is eta. It's called eta.
Yeah, sorry, sir. I didn't see that.
Okay. Anyways, let's see. Solid sphere has density which is eta times lighter. So density of the solid is density of liquid time divided by eta. Okay. Because it is this much time lighter than water. It is suspended in water tank by a string tied to the base. If the mass of the sphere is M, then the tension is asked. So this is the sphere. Tension will act downward. Okay, and there will be a buoyant force. Plus there will be a gravity force. Okay, Mg. Okay, so the sphere is at rest, the buoyant force minus mg minus t is equal to zero. All right, so t will be equal to buoyant force minus mg, and buoyant force is equal to density of liquid mass of the sphere is given. Okay, so density of solid, I'll write in terms of density of solid. It will be better that way. So density of liquid is eta times density of the solid. So buoyant force will be density of liquid, which is eta times density of solid, a rho v g minus m into g. So m is what? M is density of the solid into V. This is M, density into volume, that into G. So you'll get eta minus 1 times rho S VG. So rho S into V is mass. So eta minus 1 into M into G. Anybody got this as the answer? Okay, let me check the final answer. P is eta minus 1. Yeah, there's nothing wrong. Is there such option? Eta minus 1 into mg. D is the answer. Seventh question is D. Seventh is, yeah, we have got it correct. Okay, try doing all these fill in the blanks, 15 to 19. Sure. Do 15 to 19, fill in the blanks. You have, let's say, 10 minutes. to complete. You don't need to do it one by one, okay? You don't need to do in sequence. Do the first one, which is easier, than the next one like that. Have you done the 15th one, by the way? Anyone done 15th? Okay. How you have solved 15th? What you have done? Have you added the mass of the ball? So, is your answer 640 gram? What is the answer? Oh, so your wing pan will read less now. Something is inside, so weighing pan will, the mass of everything will increase or reduce? just 1 second. 600, assuming water was displaced. No, it's not 600. Let's see. You need to, just 1 second. See, you need to understand the free body diagram properly. Here, what is happening is that buoyant force is applied on the mass, right? Buoyant force applied on it, which is rho GV. Who is applying buoyant force? The liquid is applying buoyant force on this ball. So the ball will apply equal and opposite force on the liquid. Okay. So the rho GV force is applied on the liquid downwards. Okay. So apart from gravity force, which is mass is 0.6 kg, right? So 0.6 G plus rho GV, this will be the now the net weight. And if you talk about mass, it will be 0.6 plus rho into V. Fine. Now, rho should be density of liquid. So it will be 0.6 plus density of liquid is water, right? So this is 1000. And volume of the ball is 40 gram divided by 0.8. This volume you are going to get in cubic centimeter. You have to convert in the meter cube. So 10 to the minus 6, you have to multiply. Fine. So you'll get 0.6. Plus 40, so 10 raised to the power minus 2, then 0.4 by 0.8 into 10 raised to the power minus 1, so 0.5, so 0.6 plus 0.05. So you're going to get 0.65, which is actually equal to 650 gram. Yeah, no tension on the string. I'm not sunk into the water, and a pin of negligible volume is shown in the figure, keeping it sunk. So the what the pin is doing, there will be tension due to the pin as well. I thought it is sinking, okay? So if it is sinking, there will be tension in the string. All right. So what is the question? Even though there is a string, there will be a buoyant force by the liquid on the mass, right? So equal and opposite force will be applied on the liquid as well. All right. So 0.65 kg or 650 gram should be the answer. Let me quickly verify how much it is. 650 gram, that is correct. All right, now do the 16th one. We'll go one by one. They are not very straightforward, so we'll go one by one. Let me know if you're done 16th. Question is visible, Priti. Question number 16 I'm asking now. 1-6. You can see the question. No, Priti, please solve 16th question. I can't make everybody wait, right? I'll send you the worksheet. Then you can see it after the class, right? Do the 16th one. right now. Then 13 can be taken later on. V by 2. Kavya is getting V by 2. Others? Hollow sphere of relative density 2 floats completely immersed on the surface of water. Sorry. Shaurabh is also getting V by 2. Let's see. A hollow sphere of relative density 2. What does it mean, relative density 2? Density of the sphere is 2 times density of the water, which I am representing at as rho L. Okay, this is what it means. It is floating completely immersed on the surface of water. If the volume of sphere is V, then the volume of cavity will be what? Okay. So basically, if it would have been solid sphere, okay, if it would have been a solid sphere, then even if it is completely immersed, then also buoyant force will not be sufficient to balance the weight of the mass. Okay. So buoyant force will be density of liquid into G into total volume, and the mg will be density of solid into total volume into G. So if density of solid is more than the density of liquid for the same total volume V, it will sink down because the downward force is more. Okay, but here is a trick, that if I somehow make a cavity here, all right, if I somehow make a cavity over here where there is no material, then the mass of this hemisphere will be simply equal to density of solid into the volume of solid, which is not equal to the volume of the hemisphere. Even though the shape is hemisphere, but the density of solid you should multiply with the volume in which the material is there. You should not multiply volume of the cavity with it to get the mass. Okay, so now they can balance out because Vs could be lesser than the volume. So it can displace the volume of the hemisphere from the surface. Okay, so density of liquid G into V, when this become equal to density of solid into volume of solid into G, it is balanced. Density of solid is 2 times density of liquid. So rho L gone, then G, G is gone. So volume of solid should be equal to volume of hemisphere divided by 2. Okay. Volume of cavity will be also equal to V by 2. Solid is V by 2. Cavity should also be V by 2 because total volume is V by 2. Have you understood this question? This is very important question, slightly different. All of you understood, right? No. Okay, you can see that there is yes, no button below your chat screen. So whenever I ask you yes or no type of question, you can simply click yes. So it will show against your name. So like that, you can click. If you have not understood, you can click no. Right? All right, do the next one. Okay, Shaurabh, if you've got it, you can move on to the next one. complete all the questions. 12/3. Most of you are getting 12/3. Okay, let's see how. A cube of each side L floats in a liquid of density 3 times the density of solid. The length of the cube will be outside the liquid is how much? So let's say that this is the cube. This is submerged portion, length is X. Then this will be L minus X. Fine. So the volume of liquid that is displaced is basically X into the area of the base, right? This much liquid is displaced. So that is X into L square, fine. So buoyant force will be equal to density of liquid into X into L square, volume displaced into G. And the mg force, the weight is density of solid into total volume, which is L cube into G. I'm assuming it is like there is no cavity. So density into total volume is the mass. If there is a cavity, then this is not mass. That like the way the earlier question was. Okay. So now if it is stationary, the forces should be balanced. The mg force, which is acting down, should be equal to the buoyant force, which is acting up. Okay. So L square is gone, G is gone. So X is equal to density of solid divided by density of liquid. Now density of the liquid is 3 times the density of solid. So X will be equal to rho S by rho L times L, sorry. So this will be L by 3. So L by 3 is inside. What is asking here is length, which is outside. So L minus L by 3, which is 2L by 3. Okay. Do the 18th one. It is interesting. 18th is important.
Sigma by rho minus 1 into h.
If you've got it, then move to the next one. Others continue solving 18.
Yes, sir. The next one is it.
I'm not asking the answer for 19. When I ask, you can tell me. Okay. So you can see on your screen other questions. Question number 4 is there, right? You have to start solving that. Should I solve 18th, all of you? Okay, let me solve 18th question. So there is a wooden ball of density rho immersed in a liquid of density sigma. So this is sigma, and wooden ball has density rho up to a height capital H. It is at a height of capital H. It is then released. The height above the surface of water through which the ball rises. So when the ball reaches here, it moves up. Let's say maximum height attained is this. You need to find out what is this small h. Okay. The assumption over here is that I am assuming that the volume is very small. Okay. So it cannot be, when it is coming out, it cannot be some portion is inside the liquid, some portion is outside the liquid. either it is inside completely or outside completely, because volume I'm assuming it to be very less. Okay. And let's say that volume is V. Volume of the solid is V. So if you see that, it talks about releasing and it moving up. So basically buoyant force is more than the gravity. Otherwise it will not go up. Okay. So buoyant force is rho VG and MG force is sigma VG. Right. So total force that is acting upward, the total force that is acting upward is rho minus sigma times V into G. All right. Because of that, the acceleration is rho minus sigma times VG divided by mass. Mass is what? Sigma V, right? So V and V gone. And hence, I'm getting acceleration as rho minus sigma by sigma times G. And this is a constant acceleration. So if I release it with initial velocity zero, I can find out the final velocity over there. Okay. So final velocity, how will I get? V square is equal to U square plus 2AS. U square is zero. So V square equal to 2A, which is sigma minus rho by sigma G into H. Fine. So this is velocity square when it is just when it has just started to come out. Okay. Now I need to assume this point, which is after it leaves the liquid. Let's say this is point number one, this is point number two. So at point number one, this is the velocity. So what I'll do is I'll apply work energy theorem between point one and point two. So work energy theorem says that W is equal to U2 plus K2 minus U1 plus K1. Gravity is doing work. For that, I'm considering potential energy. So W is zero. K2 is zero because finally it stops. U1 is zero because this line I'm assuming to be zero potential energy. So U2 is equal to K1. K1 is what? Half mv square. Now, half mv square can be written as, if you multiply half into m to the v square, you get half mv square, right? So half into m into v square, then 2 and 2 goes, and you will get rho minus sigma g into h. This should be equal to u2. U2 is equal to mg into small h. Fine. So g and g gone. M is also gone. So small h will be equal to rho by sigma minus 1 times capital H. And so this is the answer for small h. Okay. Have you understood this? Those who did not, I mean, those who are not getting many questions right, don't worry. Okay. Because sometimes people do a lot of practice and they tend to remember what they have done earlier and questions get repeated, okay? So don't get intimidated by the fact that someone is getting, I'm not getting the answer, okay? There can be several reasons why somebody is able to answer some question, okay? Don't lose confidence. I have seen many such cases. So all you should focus on is your learning, whether you have understood or not. Is it clear? All right. Okay. So let's do one thing. We will now start talking about fluid dynamics. Otherwise, time will not permit us to cover the fluid dynamics. Please write down fluid dynamics. basically, let's keep it very simple. Fluid dynamics basically talks about the two equations. One is continuity equation. Which basically says that mass flow rate at steady state should be constant. What does it mean? It means that suppose there is a pipe, okay, and 2 kg per second is coming from here, then at steady state 2 kg per second should go out from there. It will never happen that 2 kg is coming from here and only 1 kg is going out per second. If that is true, then every second 1 kg is getting stored inside the pipe, which cannot happen practically. Okay, initially when pipe has no water, it will accumulate, but after it has accumulated and reached the steady state, then whatever water it is getting from the left hand side, it will reject from the right hand side. Fine. And in order to make sure continuity holds good across the two ends of a single pipe, I can use this law. Rho 1, A1, V1. This is basically mass flow rate, okay? Mass flow rate at point 1 is rho 1, A1, V1. This should be equal to rho 2 A2 V2. Okay, and if fluid is incompressible, okay, if the fluid cannot be compressed, which is usually the assumption in our syllabus, then rho 1 is equal to rho 2. You cannot compress and increase its density. So area into volume, sorry, area into velocity, sorry. Area into velocity across a pipe should be same. This is the continuity equation. It says that multiplication of area into velocity and on that cross section of the fluid is constant. Now that this is true for if you have a single pipe like this, but if you have this kind of scenario, tell me what you will say. Suppose this is what is happening. A1, V1 velocity, A2, V2 velocity, A3 and V3 velocity. Tell me what does continuity equation look like here?
V1 plus A2 is equal to...
Talking so, I can't hear. It's very feeble voice. Speak a bit loud. Kaveh is saying something. Tell everyone.
So A3 V3 equal to A1 V1 plus A2 V2.
A1 V1 plus A2 V2 is equal to A3 V3. Kaveh is saying, Andrew, A1 V1 A2 V2 is equal to A3 V3. See, you need to check from which side fluid is coming. This side it is going in and these two sides it is going out. So the amount of fluid coming in should be equal to amount of fluid that is going out. So that is the reason why A1 V1 should be equal to A2 V2 plus A3 V3. Okay. So fine. So the rate at which the fluid is coming in should be equal to rate at which fluid is going out. All right. This, by the way, area into volume, this is called volume flow rate. Volumetric flow rate. V is velocity, meter per second. Meter per second into area is meter cube per second. The volume which is flowing per second. So that is, I mean, sometime in question you will see volumetric flow rate. So that is why. Okay. So this is the continuity equation that you need to take care in the fluid dynamics. There is application of work energy theorem. There is application of work energy theorem in fluids that is called Bernoulli's theorem. Bernoulli's equation, you can say. Bernoulli's equation is nothing but application of work energy theorem. Okay. Now, work energy theorem, we already know. W is equal to U2 plus K2 minus U1 plus K1. Okay. But the problem is that it is very difficult to apply in this format when it comes to fluid. Because when it comes to fluid, we are more comfortable dealing with pressure, okay, heights and density. Instead of mass, I would like to see density when it comes to fluid. Instead of force, I would like to see pressure, because it is easy to deal with pressure as the basic laws in the fluid is with respect to pressure and density. So I would like to have this work energy theorem for fluid in terms of density and pressure. Okay. And this is how this entire equation transforms. Please write down between the two points, P1 plus half rho V1 square plus rho G H1 is equal to P2 plus half rho V2 square plus rho G H2. Okay. The assumption is streamline flow. Streamline incompressible. And no viscosity. If viscosity is there, there will be energy loss. Then this equation will not get transformed to that. Okay, it will not be so straightforward. And you can apply this equation only for a streamline flow. We'll talk about streamline flow later on if you get time. Okay. Now, this term P1 is called pressure energy. Per unit volume. This is called kinetic energy. Per unit volume. This is called potential energy per unit volume. So basically, we are dealing with the density of the energy itself when we talk about the fluid. So this is the application of work energy theorem in the fluids. Any doubts till now? Any doubts? Okay, great. So let's take up a question and see whether we can solve it. Draw this with me. So there is a beaker which is closed from the top. So pressure of the air over here is given as capital P. Pressure of the atmosphere is P naught. Okay. Fine. So this is the scenario. And let's say this distance. This is the level of water. Okay. This is the level of water. The water density is given as rho. Okay. The level of water is at a height of H2 from the floor. The hole is also there. the whole of area A1, of course, the whole area will be lesser than the area of the beaker itself. So A1 is the whole area, and that hole is at a height h1 from the base. Okay, you need to find velocity with which the water will come out from this hole. Okay, so all of you try attempting it. You just have to use Bernoulli's theorem and the continuity equation to solve this. Just attempt it. It's okay if you get it wrong also. It's fine. By the way, in case of Bernoulli's theorem, H in the Bernoulli's theorem, when you write rho g H, that H is taken from the base. Okay. But when you use Pt is equal to P1 plus rho g H, H is taken from the top. So there is a difference between the H which you have seen earlier and the H in the Bernoulli's theorem.
So can you repeat the question?
No, you can see the diagram, find the velocity.
Yeah, word, word.
Don't worry about whether it is a law or not. Just attempt it, okay? If you attempt it honestly, then you'll learn many things. All right, I will solve it now. Let's draw a streamline like this, along which I'll apply Bernoulli's theorem. So this is point two, and let's say that is point number one. So between one and two, I'm applying the Bernoulli's theorem, okay? So let's say at point number one, velocity is V1. Point number two, let's say the velocity of this is V2. even the surface will go down, right? If water is coming out, the surface will go down. So pressure at point 2 is P. So P plus rho G, H I have to take from the bottom. Let's say I'm taking this as my H equal to 0. So rho G H2, okay, plus half rho into V2 square. This should be equal to, when you come out here outside, let's say outside the pressure is atmospheric pressure, so which is P0, okay, plus rho G H1 plus half rho V1 square. All right. And continuity equation tells me that A1 into V1 should be equal to A2 into V2. Right? So whenever you see a fluid dynamics problem, you cannot think of any other equation other than Bernoulli's theorem. All right. So blindly, whenever you see a fluid that is in motion, they're asking something, just apply Bernoulli's theorem and continuity equation. So V2, I'll write V2 in terms of V1 so that I get the value of V1. So V2 is equal to this, which I'll substitute over there. So I'll get P minus P0. I'm getting P0 that side and rho G H1 also, plus rho G H2 minus H1 equals to half rho V1 square minus half rho V2 square. V2 square is A1 by A2, like this. Okay, I know that H2 minus H1 is this length, which I'll, let's say, assume as Y. Okay, H2 minus H1, let's say it is the depth at which the hole is from the surface of the water. So I'm getting half rho V1 square 1 minus A1 by A2 whole square, that is equal to P minus P0 plus rho GY. Okay. And then I can further simplify this. I'll get V1 square to be equal to P minus P0 two times of that, 2 rho GY divided by rho, then 1 minus A1 by A2 whole square. So V1 will be square root of this. Okay. Now, if container is open to the atmosphere, then basically P will be equal to the atmospheric pressure. And if the area of the hole is very small compared to the area of the beaker, I can ignore A1 by A2 whole square also. Fine. So this is gone. That is also gone. So this will get transformed to this root over 2gy V1. But this is an approximation. If you would have attempted it properly, you will get this as the answer, not that. Fine. So beaker is open and there is a small hole. If in the question it is written, it's a small hole, then velocity will be root of 2gh, sorry, 2gy, where y is the depth at which the hole resides. Any doubts, guys? Anything you want to discuss? Any doubts? Okay. Let me give you a question. All of you, please attempt this. Draw this. It's a portion of a pipe. It's not a complete pipe. It's a portion of the pipe. Like this. Okay. Let's say this is point A and that is B. Water is flowing through the horizontal pipe. Let's say water is flowing like this. Okay. The pressure of the water changes by 600 Newton per meter square between A and B. So between A and B, please write down, between A and B, the pressure change. Is 600 Newton per meter square. Okay, the area of cross section, the area of A, surface area of A, cross section area of A, 30 centimeter square, cross section area of B is 15 centimeter square. Fine, cross section area of B is also given. You need to find rate of flow of water. Rate of flow of water. Whenever somebody asks what is rate of flow of water, they are asking you volume flow rate. Okay, it means they are asking volume flow rate, which is nothing but area at any moment into velocity at that moment. Area into velocity is constant anyways. So area into velocity at any cross section, if you find, that is the answer. Can you solve this now? Anyone got it?
So is it 3.6 into 10 is to the power minus 3?
No.
Is it 1800 centimeter cube per second?
Yes. Anybody else got it? Okay. Please try it quickly. Okay, I'll attempt this now. So between point this and that, point A and point B, I can use Bernoulli's theorem. Okay, so pressure at A, let's say PA plus half rho VA square. Now, how should I write rho GH? Anyone? I can take this as my ground. Zero height. Okay, so h will be zero for A as well as for B. So I don't need to write rho gh because height is equal for both. So this is equal to pressure at B plus half rho vb square. Okay, now naturally velocity at B will be higher, so pb will be lower than pa. So PA minus PB will be half times rho into VB square minus VA square. Okay, PA minus PB is given as 600, right? So this is equal to 600. And rho is density of the water, which is 1000. 1000 divided by 2 is 500. So VB square minus VA square is 6/5. Okay, this is equation number one. And second equation is continuity equation, which says that area of A into velocity of A should be equal to area of B into velocity of B. Now, if area has the same units, centimeter square and centimeter square, you don't need to convert in meter square. Conversion factor will get cancelled away from left hand side and right hand side. So basically I'll write 30 as SA into VA is equal to 15 into VB. So from here, velocity of B is equal to 2 times the velocity at A. This is my second equation. So I'll use it there. And when I put VB over there, I'll get 4 VA square minus VA square. So I'll get 3VA square is equal to 6/5. All right. So I'll get VA as root over 2/5, which is root over 0.4. Okay. So this much is the velocity. And once velocity is known, that velocity into cross section area at A will be the this thing. Are you getting it? So VA, if you multiply with SA, you'll get volumetric flow rate, which is rate of flow of water. That into 30. Is it clear? Any doubts? Is it clear? Clear to all of you? Okay. All right. Let us take the next question. Do this. I'll tell you when you should start drawing the diagram. Now please start drawing the diagram with me. Don't wait for me to finish. Draw with me. All right, so the area of cross section of large tank, so this area is given 0.5 meter square. It has an opening near the bottom. The area of this S1, area of the tap, is given as 1 centimeter square. Okay. Fine. 20 kg is applied on the water at the top. So the mass, this mass is 20 kg. 20 kg is kept on the top. Okay. This 20 kg mass is kept on the top of this lead, which can move up and down. This surface on which this mass is kept, this surface can move up and down, and this surface is massless. It's a thin surface. Okay, 20 kg is applied on the water like this. We need to find out the velocity with which water comes out from here. Okay, this height, you can take 50 centimeters. And take G as 10. Density of water you anyway know, 1000. Okay. So I want you to solve it from scratch. Okay. It doesn't matter how many questions you solve. Whatever we are solving, let's solve it properly. Okay. So it is very similar to derivation of the Torsley's law, which we have done some time back. Okay. So another opportunity for you to apply the equations properly. Find the velocity of efflux. Anyone got the answer?
So is it 3.3 meters per second?
Who is this?
Hello?
Who has told the answer? Name? Shri. What?
Shriram.
Oh, Shriram. Yes. Others? No one. I will solve it now. Should I wait or solve? Okay, listen here. Let's say this point just below the surface is point one. Just outside the hole is point two. Okay, so I am going to apply continuity equation and the Bernoulli's equation between the two points. Fine. The Bernoulli's equation says that pressure at point one plus rho g into the h, which is 0.5 meter, 50 centimeter, right? Plus half rho into v1 square should be equal to p2 plus rho g h is zero for that, plus half rho into v2 square. Fine. And P1 can be written what? P1 can be written as atmospheric pressure plus the weight which you have kept, mg, divided by the area of cross section, which is S1. Isn't it? So if you don't place any weight over there, the pressure will be atmospheric pressure only. But since you have placed the weight, the pressure is atmospheric pressure plus weight divided by surface area. Okay. And P2 is the atmospheric pressure only. So when you substitute the value of P1 and P2, you're going to get rho g into 0.5 plus half rho v1 square. P0 and P0 will get cancelled away. So you will end up with 20 g by S1. This is equal to half rho v2 square. So basically we need to find v2, okay? And I also know that s1 into v1 is equal to s2 into v2, okay? S1 is 0.5 meter square. That into v1 is equal to 1 centimeter square, which is 10 is power minus 4 meter square to v2. Okay, so V2 will be equal to 5 10 to the power 4, right? So it's like 5,000. So this is 5,000 times V1. So when you substitute, V1 is equal to V2 by 5,000 over here. Over here, you'll get the value of V2. Getting it? So you may not have got the answer. The calculation is not straightforward. So others have used the calculator, but this is how you have to solve it. Is it clear to all of you? Okay. So we'll take a small break now. We forgot to take a break. Oh, it's already close to 7. So no need to take a break now. It's already close to 7. Fine, let's take up questions. Question number 10, can you solve quickly? 10. Krishna Bajaj is saying B. Others? B. Sahana is also saying B. All right, so let's check here. Pressure at points along the axis. Now tell me, pressure over here will be more or over there will be more? Where the pressure will be higher, point one or point two? We know according to Bernoulli's theorem, P plus half rho V square, pressure plus this expression, P1 plus half rho V1 square is P2 plus half rho V2 square. So at point two, velocity is higher. So pressure will be lower. Okay. At point one, velocity is lower. So pressure will be higher. Okay. So it cannot be B. And pressure cannot be constant also because velocity is changing. If this is increasing, this should decrease. That's why A. Fine. Okay. Let's take up a question which is coming in my mind. All of you draw this. A bucket you have to draw, open to the atmosphere, right? And bucket is completely filled with water. At the bottom, there is a small hole. Okay. Bottom, there is a small hole and the area of cross-section of this hole is S1. Area of cross-section of the bucket is S2. S1 is very small compared to S2. Fine. So you can use the final expression of torsionally directly at any moment. So let's say this height is h. Okay, water keeps coming out from here. You need to find how much time it will take for bucket to get empty. All right, how much time it will take for the bucket to become empty? Find out. Have you attempted? Should I solve? How many of you want to take a break? You can tick, you can click the tick button. No break. Great. All right. Attempt this question, then we'll continue. Should I solve it now? Okay, let me solve it. No one is telling me the answer. So let's say that after some time, the height of the liquid becomes this much. Okay. Let's say this is h, small h. Okay. So the velocity of efflux according to the this thing, root 2 gh, Tauscher's law. Okay. And I know that s1 into v, which is 2 gh, is equal to s2 into velocity of this surface. Why I'm finding the velocity of the surface? Because if I get the velocity with which it is coming down, I will know velocity with which the height is decreasing. Then I can talk about time when the entire bucket will be empty. Okay, this velocity is more helpful. The velocity with which this is going down. Okay, so velocity with which it is going down is S1 by S2 times root of 2GH. Okay, and this velocity, you can write it as dH by dt. Fine. The dH over here is negative, by the way. Whenever some velocity comes out, h is decreasing. So dH is negative. So minus dH by dt you can put. Or you can take care of signs later on as well. No problem. So dH by dt is equal to minus of S1 by S2 root of 2GH. Fine. So dH divided by root h will be equal to minus of S1 by S2 dt. Now you have to integrate it. Why I have to integrate? Because velocity keeps on changing. It changes with h. So I've written velocity in terms of h and then equated to dh by dt. 0 to t, and height earlier was capital H. Now it should be 0 if I'm talking about a total heat, total water loss. Integral of dh by root h is 2 root h. From h to 0, this is equal to minus of S1 by S2 times t. Okay. So t will come out to be 2 times root of capital H S2 by S1. Something is missing. dH by dt is root 2g also. There is wait. Two H by G. This is what you get. Fine. All right. Let's get into the problem solving of this. Now look at the question number 14 to 15. This one. Try solving it. Anybody is able to solve this? 14th question. 1-4.
These are actually very good, Amma.
Hmm. Keep it up.
No one got 14th. Okay, I think because break is not given, you guys are like totally drained out. And we will take a small break, otherwise you'll drain out. So we'll take a five, six minutes break. Right now it is 7:06. Okay. We will meet at 7:15. Okay. Let's meet again for 15 minutes. We'll solve a couple of questions. Take a small break. Okay. Come back refreshed. Okay. If you want to attempt the question during the break, please do so. Are you guys back from much needed break? Are you guys there?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so now let's get it. We have 15 of the class left. Lot of disturbance from somewhere. Who is disturbing? Shiramya. Who is disturbing Shiramya? I think it was from someone. Now you can hear. All right, anybody got the answer? 14th, should I solve? By the way, these worksheets were given as a homework last year. So, looks like you have not done your homework. Anyways, I'll solve it now. A syringe as shown in figure contains an ideal fluid of density rho. The cross-section area of plunger A and a small orifice at the end of the cylinder has area A. Okay, the velocity of outflow of liquid on the syringe, if the plunger moves, the constant velocity under the action of force is what? So if the plunger is moving with constant velocity, it means that the force from this side is equal to force from that side. Okay. So this force which you are applying to the plunger is equal to the force the fluid is applying on the plunger. Because of that, the pressure of the fluid becomes force per unit area, F by A. Okay. So over here, pressure because of the force is F by A plus atmospheric pressure, P naught. So total pressure over here is P naught plus F by A. Okay. So if I apply Bernoulli's theorem between this point one and point two, okay, I will get P1 plus half rho V1 square is equal to P2 plus half rho V2 square. Fine. And one more thing, I am saying that there is a small orifice. Okay. So velocity of 0.2 is very high compared to velocity of 0.1. So I can ignore the velocity of 0.1. Okay. This is the same thing which we have done when we have derived for the Tauchery's law. So P1 is atmospheric pressure plus F by A. This is equal to P2, which is atmospheric pressure outside the orifice, atmospheric pressure plus half rho V square. So P and P gone. So velocity will be equal to root of 2F by A rho. Option A. Okay. 15th. Anyone? 15th. See, work done by a force is force into displacement. Simple. Okay. So force you are applying is capital F. So capital F into displacement should be the work done. Okay. So the work done should be equal to force into the displacement, and displacement will be what? Velocity with which this is going for, let's say velocity is u. So u into t. T is the time taken to empty. So assuming the velocity with which the plunger is moving with constant, which is written over here, it moves with a constant velocity. Because of that, velocity into time should be the displacement. So work done is force into u into t. Okay. But the options are given in terms of density and volume. Fine. So let's try to simplify this further. First of all, this is the velocity with which the water will come out. Okay. So the velocity of the plunger, how to get that? So velocity of plunger, let's say u, and that into a is a1 v1. This should be equal to small a into this velocity which you have found out. It will be 2f by capital A rho. All right, so velocity u will be equal to a by capital A divided into 2f by a rho. So this is the velocity u. So you can substitute that over here. So f into u a by capital A root over 2f by a rho into t. This is the work done. Now, how to simplify this further? Anyone? The volume of fluid is given as V. Okay. So the volume of fluid is how much? U into T into the area of cross section. This should be equal to V. All right. So from here, you'll get T equals to volume of fluid divided by U into A. Okay. In fact, you can directly substitute U into T. So U into T should be equal to V by A. So work done is force into volume divided by area of cross section A. Fine. Now, basically, we need to find out what is the value of capital F. Fine. So capital F, if T is given, you can find out that I have to erase this everything, is it? Okay, anyways. So the capital F, whatever it is, that divided by A should be equal to half rho into V square. This is what it says. Okay. So you can substitute this velocity in terms of the velocity of plunger, and u into t is the v divided by a. So you can use all of that. I mean, it will take a lot of time over here. So you just have to basically modify this expression and get it in terms of density rho, volume, and time. You need to eliminate f from here. Okay. So use Bernoulli's theorem and continuity theorem to eliminate F from this equation, you will get the answer. Okay. We can try out a couple of more questions. The surface tension. So guys, surface tension we could not do. So I will send you a set of my videos. So please watch it so that you are comfortable with the entire chapter. Okay. So once you watch the surface tension videos also, you can say that the chapter is done. Fifth question. Try solving the question number 5. That is the last question for today. Try solving it. Okay, somebody got some answer. Preeti saying A. Others? See, here what is happening is that the water is coming out. Because of that, there will be an action and reaction pair. I will show you. First, all of you attempt this. All right, so assuming all of you have attempted it at least. So light container. So container has no mass. Because of that, it is written light container. So whatever is the mass, that is the mass of the liquid only. It is kept on a horizontal rough surface. Coefficient of friction is this. A very small hole is made at the depth H. So very small hole means that I can use a Torsielli's law and I can say velocity is root over 2gh. Directly I can say that. Water of volume V is filled in the container. Let's see. So water of volume V is filled in a container. The friction is not sufficient to keep the container at rest. The acceleration of container initially is how much? Okay, so what will happen is let's try to find out what force the cylinder will experience because water is coming out. So velocity is root of 2gh. Okay. So dm by dt, rate at which the water is coming out, kg per second, is rho into area of cross section, s into v, rho a v. This is rate at which the water is coming out, dm by dt. And rate of change of momentum can be written as velocity into dm by dt. Over here, velocity is constant at that moment. We can assume that. Okay. So dm by dt into velocity is rate of change of momentum. So velocity is root 2gh. So this can be written as rho s into 2gh. Root 2gh becomes 2gh. Okay, this is the dp by dt, rate at which momentum is changing, right? This you can say is also the force between the liquid that is moving out and the rest of the container. So the rest of the container will feel a force of this much, which is rho s into 2gh. Okay, and on top of it, it has a frictional force as well. Since friction is not sufficient, it will create a maximum amount of friction, which is mu times n. So this is n and that is mg. So normal force is equal to m into g, where m can be written as surface area s into h, okay, into rho to g. I am assuming that the hole is at the bottom, okay. So surface area H becomes volume, volume into density become mass, and this is G. So normal action is this much, okay? So force of friction is mu times normal reaction. Okay, so, so friction is given in terms of V only. So I need not assume that H is the bottom. So I can assume the total volume is V. So I can write formulation as V into rho into G. V into rho is mass. Okay. So friction force is mu into normal reaction and mu is S H by total volume. So mu into normal reaction, which is V rho G, V and V gone. So S H rho G is the frictional force. Okay. So total force will be F minus frictional force. F is 2 times S rho GH and friction is S rho GH. So F minus FR becomes rho S GH. Okay, this is your force. This force should be equal to mass into acceleration, right? So mass of the liquid is density of the liquid into volume, that into acceleration, which is A, let us say. So density and density gone. So acceleration can be written as S H G divided by V. So answer is D. Understood, all of you? Is it clear? Please copy it down quickly. This is important. All right. So after the class, I'll circulate a video on the rest of the chapter, which is surface tension and viscosity. These two topics are very important, but today we could not get time. But since you guys are in flow, because we have touched upon the other portion of the chapter, I recommend that you should complete the entire chapter as a revision. Okay, I'll send you the videos, watch it, if possible, maybe tomorrow after your English exam, complete it and solve a couple of questions on surface tension. I'll send this worksheet. This worksheet has those questions on surface tension and finish this chapter off completely. All right. So that's it for today. We will see you soon. Bye.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.